Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Sam Simpson. Homework Hotline is a place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial-A-Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your question. All right, before we get to our creature teaser, we want to let our viewers know that a little later in the show, Kayla and Dan from the Rochester Museum and Science Center will be here to talk to us more about frogs.
And now it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for our creature teaser.
All right, let's do it.
This giant creature lives in the ocean and can weigh up to 5,000 pounds. That's 60 million times its original weight when it's first hatched. It is the largest of all the bony fish, measuring up to 14 feet long from the face to tail and 10 feet around from the back to the stomach. This creature has an unusual shape because its tail fin does not grow with the rest of it.
Interesting. This fin, called the clavis, and it remains short and round, adding to the fish's overall roundness. This omnivore enjoys jellyfish, small fish, and microscopic plants and animals. It also enjoys sunning itself near the ocean surface, which is why it is called a sunfish. Swimmers sometimes make this mistake or mistake this creature for a shark because of its tall dorsal fin.
If you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer the question correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
And every correct response we added to our Hotline Hall of Fame, earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season. Are you ready, Sam?
I'm ready.
All right, we got some homework out there.
Great.
Hello? Hello? I think we have someone out there for homework. Hello? All right, I'm gonna go over to the board here and we're gonna do a little science, I think, instead here. I gotta go back over here and I'm gonna click on my thing here and this is throwing us off. All right, so we started with the skeletal system and we've been continuing with the skeletal system, so I'll talk a little bit more about this. So we are able to do our things and walk around and talk and dance and brush our teeth and feed ourselves all because of this system here. So we've gone through some of this already. And our skeletal system gives us our shape, but it doesn't let us move unless we have these right here. And this is our muscles. Now, when we look at our muscles that we have that control our body that we use to do everything that we do for us and for our survival, they classify the muscles into two main kinds of groups, all right? The first kind of group are voluntary muscles, and those are the muscles that you actually control, like move arm, stand on a foot, open and close my mouth, write my notes, feed myself. Those are all because my brain tells my muscles to do stuff, and they do those things for us. So those are called voluntary muscles, all right? Now, the second kind of muscles, which are working in the background, but just as important, are the involuntary muscles, all right? Involuntary muscles are ones that you have no control over, and they're gonna do their job regardless. Some of the kinds of muscles that are involuntary are the muscles that control your pupil. And one thing that if you ever play a sport and you ever bonk your head, maybe you play football, run through the line with your head down instead of keeping up like the coach is telling you, you might bonk your head and you get little flashes of light or something for a second. One of the things they're gonna check is how your pupils respond. And what they're looking for is both pupils should respond at the same time. And it's something that you can't control. So the doctor takes a flashlight and they flick it in your eyeball and you see the pupil close really fast. If one closes a little slower than the other, then it tells the doctor, well, something happened inside the brain. Maybe you bounced your brain inside your skull a little bit, or you traumatized an area and you're causing some pressure in there. So they're going to be very concerned for a little while. So you're going to go home, or maybe they're going to keep you at the hospital and monitor. All right. And they want to make sure that the neurological connections in there are working properly. That's an involuntary muscle control. Another one is our heart. Even though our heart is a cardiac muscle, which is only in the heart, you really have no control over it. All right, it's going to work all by itself. All right, so we're going to talk about now, after the two classes of muscles, the voluntary and involuntary, we break that down into three types of muscles. All right, the first one are the skeletal muscles. All right, and these are voluntary. These are the muscles that control our skeleton. All right, and these are voluntary muscles, or voluntary muscles. All right, voluntary. All right, there's also another term that they use, and it's called striated. And the reason they call it striated is because if you look at the muscle under a microscope, it kind of has bands, and they call them an A band and a Z band. And it's those bands that come closer together or farther apart when the muscle contracts or relax. All right, so we have a skeletal muscle and a striated muscle. The next one we have are smooth muscles, all right? All right, smooth muscles are involuntary. All right, involuntary muscles, again, are muscles that you don't have any control over. These are going to be located on the internal organs, our intestines, our eyeball, like I was telling about. Now, these are for long, kind of slow kinds of contractions. All right, now a contraction is actually a term referring to when a muscle gets shorter. All right, and it goes back to those A and Z bands in a striated muscle. So two muscles so far is the skeletal muscle and a smooth muscle. And like I was saying just a little bit ago, we have our third type of muscle, which is cardiac. And cardiac muscle is heart muscle, and it's only located in the heart. All right, now cardiac is similar to striated or skeletal muscles in that it is striated, meaning it has stripes on it, and it actually looks very similar to a skeletal muscle. The second part that a cardiac muscle is, it is involuntary, which means I can't control my heart. I can't go stop beating. It's going to beat all by itself and keep going. All right, so it's involuntary muscle. All right, so now with the combination of these three muscles, our skeletal muscles, which you can control, they're voluntary, they're striated. Sometimes they're called, and actually a skeletal muscle they'll refer to them as, because it moves the skeleton. It's connected to my bone, my finger, my jaw, all the things in here that we move around and think about moving around. The second muscles are our smooth muscles. Those are internal organs, the pupil of the eyeball, some other muscles, your throat. Once you start swallowing, once it gets to a certain point, you can't stop it from swallowing. It's just going to go all by itself. All right. The smooth muscles are responsible for long, slow contractions. Like, think about how long it takes the food to get through your body. Imagine if your muscles had to contract. If you were running up and down stairs for 24 hours, you'd like pass out because you'd be out of energy. But these muscles can do that. They can squeeze and contract and squeeze and contract. Real, real slow, long contractions. Okay. The next ones, again, is our cardiac. And again, we're going to put over here that this is in the heart. All right, sometimes referred to as a heart muscle or cardiac. That's the only place in your body you're going to have it. It is similar to skeletal, that it's striated. It's also similar to smooth, that it's involuntary. All right, so those are the three muscles, and we're going to continue building on our knowledge of the human body system as we go along. And I hope that that helps you guys out a lot. Thanks a lot. I said,
hey, hey. Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Yeah.
All right, tonight our friends from the Rochester Museum and Science Center are here to talk to us about the tomato frog. Hi, Dan. How are you?
Good to see you.
How are you, Kayla?
Hi. I'm good. How are you?
Got your hands full there.
Yeah, I do.
All right, so what is this that you're holding?
This is actually a false tomato frog.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah. So can you tell us about this tomato frog?
Well, false tomato frogs. Tomato frogs are mainly from Madagascar. It's a very small place for them to come from. So that's basically where they all are from right now.
Okay.
Yeah.
You can tell by the color of the red.
Yeah,
tomato.
Very much. Right. Not something you see around here.
Yeah. Looks like something you would put on your sandwich, right?
Right.
We live in an environment that's rich in iron oxide, red pigmented minerals in the soil that help and keep it camouflaged from predators.
Mm-hmm. Yep, they like to live in very heavy rain water areas, so in grasses and in forests also.
Cool.
It's a female.
This is actually, yes, a large female. She's the largest one we have on exhibit right now, frogs.
Right.
And females are actually much larger than the males are, and they're actually brighter in color as well.
Does the frog give off a toxin?
They actually do. It's not toxic to people just by holding them, but it is toxic if you ingest it. So it actually causes a severe anaphylaxis of some sort. That's what it mimics in a way. And for predators that are like snakes are one of their natural predators that'll try and eat them. They'll try and bite them, and then they'll give us this toxin, and then they'll get very thick, mucusy feeling, and their eyes will get weird too. So
the frog will, or the
the snake will.
So it's pretty rapid the toxins take them out.
Yes, it does. So then the animal will drop them and leave them alone. But their bright colors tell other species that they are highly toxic of some sort.
Just like others, like butterflies, like the monarch butterfly.
Yes, bright colors in the wild mean I am toxic in some way. So like poison dart frogs are highly toxic, very toxic to
humans.
Yellow
jackets.
Yes, bright colors mean I am poisonous.
Right.
So you don't want to mess with anything bright colored, but animals also adapt to that too. Okay.
So now, because they're from such a small island, Madagascar, is their environment being threatened in any way?
Yes, deforestation is always a problem there. Also, pet trade is an issue as well. People like to take animals from the wild, and there's not a lot in the wild because they're only in Madagascar. I like to say that animals from Madagascar, like lemurs, are all threatened because if something happened to that one island, what would happen to all the species?
Right.
They'd all be gone.
What does it mean to have when a species is threatened?
That they could become endangered or even extinct one day.
Uh-huh. And pet trade stresses the species by creating a demand for them.
Exactly.
So,
is that primarily in the United States or is that throughout the world?
Around the world, pet trade is a big problem. One of the messages in this exhibition, this particular species is one of 16 on display at the Science Center, and that we're trying to get people to think more deeply about frog species, not just what the value or the merit of keeping them in the wild, but also the messages they reveal about the quality of our environment. They're a bellwether species, so you can tell by the health of certain amphibians how healthy the environment is.
Right, because they take a lot of toxins, a lot of things right through their skin.
Exactly. That's why I'm wearing gloves right now.
Okay.
I don't want her to take anything from my skin and absorb it through hers because their skin is very permeable.
And her being so toxic, you wouldn't want to be...
No, exactly. I wouldn't want to touch her and then touch my face or my mouth
Would anyone want that frog as a pet?
They do. People actually think that they're great pets, but they're really not because they are so... they're near threatened in the wild, but people think of them as good pets. But I think frogs in general aren't great pets because they're hard to take care of in any aspect.
So if I'm out walking in the woods and I see a frog and my kid's like, hey, wow, can we take it home? I should say no. We'll come back and visit it here.
Yes, yes. And if they try to pick it up, make sure you have gloves first.
Okay.
Yeah.
I never would have thought of the glove thing, especially with like toads, you hand them all the time as a kid.
I mean, I know kids that pick them up all the time, but I always say try to pick them up with something to protect yourself and also them as well.
Sure. Is there research that are currently being done with frogs, particularly that one or others?
Yeah, actually in this, we're extending this exhibition through April to take a closer look at other research in the community. And one of the special presentations affiliated with the exhibition is a presentation by Dr. Jack Rubbert at the University of Rochester, who studies the transmission of viruses and the clawed African water frog, Xenopus. We have a tank of them in the exhibit. They're a magnificent looking frog, but they also tell a really interesting story about the spread of viruses in bodies of water as people trade these pets in the exotic pet trade. The viruses have been traveling with them. It's an interesting story, and we're going to look at that in the spring in our evening lecture series.
Okay.
So now one of my questions that, like, being that this is an exotic kind of animal, and we've had other kinds of exotic animals be introduced into ecosystems ecosystems in the United States, the zebra mussel, the goby fish, and there's other plants. Would that pose a big threat in the same respect? Like if that frog or a similar frog from Madagascar got out, would it survive and be able to be a nuisance like some of these other things?
I mean, if it was released into the right areas where there's heavier rains and stuff like that, similar to their habitat in Madagascar, it could become a problem because, like cane toads in Australia, they're introduced there by humans thinking that they could take care of another issue, but they actually are causing more of an issue there with causing deaths to their native species compared to the invasive species.
The issue of invasives is a huge one, and it's one that we're looking at in all different contexts. In this particular case, it would depend on what other relationships exist in that ecosystem,
gotcha,
and what predator and prey relationship is being disrupted.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Is there any exciting news about the exhibit that's going on?
Well, it's done really well. The way the exhibit has been designed is we've added a great deal of story spaces, and the one thing we're particularly proud of is we've gone into our collection of 1.2 million objects, and we pulled from our Native American collections totem poles and icons that show the frog as symbols of water and prosperity. So when we presented this exhibition, when we chose it because we were able to do different things with it. We're featuring live animal presentations every weekend, mm-hmm, live animal feedings. It's just a different experience for the Science Museum. And it has done so well, we elected to keep it through April 10th, and we're really excited.
So if kids want to get there, they need to get there before
April 10th.
Please.
All right.
Yeah.
Come see us.
It's an awful lot of fun, and we've had a great deal of excitement around it. It's
great.
Great.
Dan, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure.
Kayla,
thank you.
Air 5.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Okay. If you want to know more about this animal and others like it, go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on the videos. Now stay right there. We'll be back in a second.
I said, hey, hey.
How do you know which century you live in? The 21st century is the 2000s. The 20th century is the 1900s. The 19th century is the 1800s. The 18th century is the 1700s. The 17th century is the 1600s, and so on.
All right, that was a very good segment. What do
yes,
you think?
Yes, it was.
Very cool.
Interesting.
And I liked the red frog thing. That was kind of cool with the iron oxide. But we have Lanijah out there. Hi, Lanijah. How are you?
Hi.
You have a math question. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to go over to the phone. While I'm doing that, turn your TV down. Listen to me on your headset, okay?
Hold on. Let me go put it on my headset.
All right, cool. So, Lanijah, what are we working on? What kind of math problem? Something about distances, right? Okay. So I'm gonna draw. We have something in the middle. What's that? What are we gonna label this thing in the middle of our problem here?
We gotta make a number line.
Okay. Does it matter if I go horizontal or vertically?
Huh?
Do I have to go up and down or side to side? All right, so I'm going to got my number line. I got a box in the middle, and I got a number line going through my box. Okay, what are we going to do now?
I got a box in the middle, and I got the number line going through the box. Okay, what are we going to do now?
Then we got to, like, set the numbers down.
Okay.
Make it, like, zero in the middle.
Okay, I got my number line, got some hash marks on it. We got directions. What are we placing on our number on our number line?
We'll make it zero in the middle.
Okay, we have zero in the middle.
Then we got the other numbers on the side.
All right, now if I'm looking at a number line, and I know when I move to the right, the numbers are going to increase. So this is going to be a positive number this way. So we've got positive 1, 2, 3, 4, and I'm going to make my fifth line a little bit longer than the rest, so I know that's 5. And my next one there is going to be longer, and I'm going to put a 10 out here and a 5. And then if I need to count the individual ones, I can. I can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. All right. And I know when I move to the left of my zero, I'm going to do the same thing. I've got negative 1, negative 2, 3, 4, and I'm going to make this one just a little bit longer. So that's minus 5. And then I got 6, 7, 8, 9, and I'm going to make that one a little bit longer and say minus 10. Okay. So now we have our number line set up. What do we have to do with our number line?
We got a label.
Okay, so we've got that. I think we've got our positive labeled here. I'll put, I don't know, we could put parentheses around this. That's a positive side. Parentheses around that side. That's our positive and our negative. Okay. What okay. Are we going to place some objects on here that we have to calculate now, distances or something?
Yeah.
Okay, where's the object going to go to the right on the positive?
What'd you say?
What object are we going to put to the positive, and how far positive are we going to put it?
I'm not sure.
Let's pick this. I'm going to put something right here, and we're going to, I'll draw a circle. And we're going to say, okay, if I count from zero to the right to my circle at my indicator, how far positive have I moved that, how far positive has that object moved from zero? So I would come over here and I would count. I'd go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and this is going to be a positive 9. Okay, so that whatever that object is 9 spaces or 9 nine digits away from zero. Let's put one on the other side and let's go right here. So I'm going to pick a spot just after 5. I'll put a little triangle and I'm going to say, okay, now what is the distance from zero to the left to our triangle? So I'm looking over here. I go 1, 2, 3, 4. I got my minus 5, minus 1. I got minus 6. All right?
Yeah.
So now I'm going to throw you a curveball. I'm going to say, what is the distance between my triangle and my circle? All right? So now you're going to tell me, how can we figure out the distance between our triangle and our circle? Because I know that distance isn't negative. It's got to be a positive distance, right? So how could I calculate the distance between my circle from zero and my triangle from zero?
How can I
right? I could add these together, right?
Yeah.
So I have a negative 6, and I'm going to add a negative 6 to a positive 9. That sounds kind of confusing, doesn't it? So how far did this actually travel, the triangle? How long is this? If I measured that out, what is the distance there? That's a positive unit of 6 units, correct? And then the distance from 0 to our circle at the other end is a positive 9. So now, what would be my total distance of 9 plus 6?
15,
right? 9 plus 6 is going to give me a total distance of 15. And I'm going to write down here, because our teachers always like to have us label things as units, because I don't know if I'm measuring in millimeters or centimeters or whatever, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So I hope that helps you out. I hope that helps our other viewers out as well. Thanks.
When multiplying fractions, begin by multiplying the numerators of the fraction, and then multiplying the denominators of the fraction.
All right, we have a winner in tonight's creature teaser. All right. So, Anat?
Yes.
How is it? What is this fish, or what is this animal that we're talking about?
It's called the mola mola.
Mola mola.
Mola. Wow. Never heard of it.
I have not. So, were there some clues that we gave you that you used, or did you already know this?
I used a large bony fish.
Okay.
And I remembered at school we were learning about the ocean.
Cool.
And they said that mola mola was the largest bony fish.
Wow.
So now you mentioned a word there, bony fish. What does that tell you or tell us, our viewers, about this kind of fish?
Well, it tells us that it has bones, which probably yields to more mass.
Okay.
Okay.
One thing I can tell you is there's bony fish and then there's cartilaginous fish. Like a shark, their skeleton's made out of cartilage. And a bony fish is like you and I, where their skeleton's made out of bone.
Okay.
Something a little different there. Is there anything else that you learned that you could tell us about this moly moly?
Moly moly.
It has a flat shape. It's okay. Not that very thick.
So flat like a Frisbee? Flat like a Frisbee?
Not flat like a Frisbee, but pretty flat.
All right. Well, congratulations. Yes. Don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all that we have time for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dollar Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone tonight until 7.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we continue our American Graduate Series. Elliot Williams will be here to tell us about his story and his path to a higher education. Good night.
Good night, guys.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.